In the last few decades, sophisticated instruments have been developed to study cells, the basic units of life. One of them is the cell sorter. By measuring the physical and chemical properties of cells, and then by physically separating them, the cell sorter has become an important tool for biomedical research and clinical medicine. In a cell sorter, cells are suspended in a liquid and forced under pressure in single file into the center of a fluid stream. The stream passes through a vibrating nozzle, which causes it to break up into droplets, up to as many as 40,000 a second. Below the nozzle, and before the stream breaks up, it passes through laser light, allowing measurements to be made by sensors, particularly if cells have been tagged with fluorescent materials which shine in the laser beam. After desired cells pass through the laser beam, they are electrically charged, positive or negative, and continue to fall by gravity until they reach electrical deflecting plates. The cells are then deflected to the left or right based on their charge and fall into collecting tubes. Droplets lacking cells, or containing unwanted ones, continue to fall straight into a collecting vessel. Today, cell sorters are being used to study how cells function in the immune system, how infectious diseases arise, and how the body responds to them. Of crucial interest is the immune response to HIV, the human immunodeficiency virus, the cause of AIDS. Cell sorters are also being used to study parts of the cell, especially chromosomes and their DNA content, important for understanding how cancer cells function and for mapping the human genome. This program outlines the story of the cell sorter's development. Cells are the basic units of living organisms. Their study has been crucial to the understanding of plant, animal, and human biology. Since the 17th century, the microscope has been the major tool for cell research. The development of synthetic dyes for staining cells in the mid-19th century and of newer and more powerful optical systems greatly enhanced the process. What the cell sorter adds is the ability to separate large numbers of functionally different, although closely related, cells from an organ and to keep them alive so their functions can be studied under controlled conditions. The Los Alamos Scientific Laboratory in New Mexico, during World War II, the home of the Manhattan Project and creation of the atomic bomb. Los Alamos was also the seemingly unlikely birthplace, some years later, of the cell sorter. A key player in its development was Marvin Vandilla, a young physicist at the time, who remembers the role biomedicine played at Los Alamos.
The Manhattan Project was set up in the 40s, 41 actually, a very important radiation protection biomedical component was set up to be sure that the people who worked on it didn't get hurt. And so the biological hazards of radiation and the question, what does radiation do anyway when it falls upon living tissue and living cells, was very important from the very beginning. And so when the Atomic Energy Commission was set up in 45 as a civilian commission to take over all of this work, an important part of its function was this area of biomedical research. In fact, in the 30s and 40s, rather in the late 40s and 50s, AEC funding in this country exceeded NIH funding of biological research. And NIH caught up and took over as it grew in the 40s. But for a while, the AEC was funding most of the biomedical research in the U.S.
Another young physicist, Mac Fulweiler, joined Marvin Vandilla's biomedical group at the Los Alamos Laboratory in 1962.
When I first went to Los Alamos and went to work under Marv Vandilla, our primary interest was in monitoring the fallout from atmospheric nuclear weapons testing, that fallout appearing in milk and meats and other food products. With the arrival of the Atmospheric Nuclear Test Ban Treaty, the appearance of fallout, radioactive fallout, in the diet and in humans diminished. And so we had much less to do in terms of monitoring fallout. So our group, which consisted of four individuals, three physicists and a physical chemist, looked around to see what we could do to assist the biologists, who were the other 60-some people of the group.
Fulweiler's attention was drawn to the biologists' use of a Coulter counter to analyze blood. The Coulter counter suspended blood cells in salt water and pulled them through a small orifice. As each cell passed through the orifice, it caused an electrical pulse proportional to its size. Thus, the instrument was able to count the number of cells in the sample and measure their size. What bothered Mac Fulweiler was that he thought a colleague was misinterpreting the results of experiments with red blood cells using the Coulter counter, and in order to disprove these findings, he needed a means to separate specific portions of red blood cell populations. This set him off on a quest to build a cell sorter.
I set out to look for ways to physically isolate cells based on some electrically generated signal. And I started off looking at valves, mechanical valves, which could be electrically switched and move a flowing stream of liquid from one channel into another channel and then back. But when you look into that, it's a very slow process and you could not process cells very rapidly. Then I saw a paper by Dick Sweet, who at that time was at Stanford Research Institute, working on I believe it was a Navy project, maybe an Air Force project, to develop an ink-writing oscillograph, which is a device that produces a jet of ink in the air.
What Richard Sweet invented was the inkjet printer, a device which breaks a stream of ink into droplets, electrically charges them, and then deflects them into patterns forming letters and numbers, all at high speed. Fulweiler's interest was in combining this inkjet technology with the Coulter counter to produce an instrument that could sort cells.
What I put together initially was the idea of using a Coulter volume sensor, which generates an electronic signal proportional to the size of the object, and this ink writing oscillograph, which partitioned a stream of liquid into small droplets, which could then be charged and individually deflected. So I saw these small droplets as really just carriers for a cell, as a means of moving a cell around. So that was the initial idea. I put out a letter describing the process to a number of scientists in the laboratory, Los Alamos Scientific Laboratory, and I've forgotten the exact number, but I think about 8 people I asked for their opinions on whether or not the method would work. The majority came back saying, no, it probably wouldn't work for various reasons. But under the encouragement of my boss, Wright Langham and Marv Vandilla, I went ahead and tried it and made a trip out to visit Dick Sweet at Stanford Research Institute.
In the summer of 1963, he came out and visited me and told me a bit about his work. And we had some conversations which were interesting to both of us, I think. I knew nothing at all about cells at the time. And he went back to Los Alamos with some borrowed equipment of mine and started work on what became the first cell sorter.
Marvin Vandilla recalls that support at the time was never really a problem. His and Fulweiler's group leader, Wright Langham, was able to draw on funds from various nuclear weapons programs to cover costs. Langham also provided his own kind of personal support.
Really, our group leader, Wright Langham, gets a lot of credit, should get a lot of credit in all of this, because he not only got these two diverse types of people together, but was very supportive and encouraging throughout the whole development. Although the way he encouraged it was to come down to the lab and look at what you were doing and get you to explain it in detail and then shake his head and say, that'll never work. And that made you so mad that you would damn sure to get it working. But that was his style of management, and it was great, although at the time it seemed irksome.
In the end, Mac Fulweiler and his colleagues succeeded in building an instrument that could sort cells based on their size or volume. He described his invention in an article in Science in 1965 and received a patent for it 3 years later. The physicists, Van Dille and Fulweiler, used the sorter for a variety of experiments they conducted themselves, but they were not successful at getting the biological group at Los Alamos excited about the new instrument, even though it allowed for quantifying and analyzing large numbers of cells quickly and accurately. The story continues back at Stanford. The first biologists who clearly saw uses for the Los Alamos instrument, especially for the study of the immunological properties of cells, were Leonard and Lenore Herzenberg. Len and Lee have been living and working together since they met as undergraduates at Brooklyn College. Their personal lives and professional careers have blended to such an extent that their laboratory has become a part of their family. Before coming to Stanford in 1959, they were at the California Institute of Technology, where Len did his graduate work. They both had shared an exciting time in Paris at the Pasteur Institute, working on enzyme induction in the laboratory of Nobel laureate Jacques Monod. After Paris, they spent 2 years at the NIH, the National Institutes of Health in Maryland. Then they headed west to the genetics department at Stanford, where they have been ever since. Herzenberg's interest in sorting cells developed very early on in his career. He wanted to separate cells that he could see were different under the microscope and study their function while they were still alive. While searching for a way to do this, he heard about the work of Mac Fulweiler.
Our motivation was that we wanted to look at and then sort live cells so that we could do immunological experiments and genetic experiments. And that meant we had to have live cells sorted and then analyzed. The machine at Los Alamos, New Mexico, which had been built by Mac Fulweiler, who deserves credit for having built the first sorter. When I went to Los Alamos, I asked Fulweiler if he would consider putting fluorescence onto the machine. And Fulweiler said, well, that isn't our particular interest. So I asked him if we could have the plans for the machine. He said, sure, we can give you the plans, and he gave us the plans.
Back at Stanford, Herzenberg obtained the cooperation of engineers in the genetics department's instrumentation research laboratory to build an instrument that would sort live cells using fluorescence. These engineers began by working with Fulweiler's plans and with a rapid cell spectrophotometer that had been given to Stanford by International Business Machines. It was built in IBM's Watson Laboratory at Columbia University by Louis Kamensky in order to help automate cervical cancer screening. The goal of the Stanford engineers was to build a cell sorter which sorted live cells primarily by fluorescence. They had to overcome major problems in fluidics, optics, and electronics. Dick Sweet, who had been made a member of the team, recalls the problem with fluidics.
We were working with very tiny jets, of course. There are about ones we started with, and still are, about 2 or 3 one-thousandths of an inch in diameter. And the precision with which we wanted to locate the cell in the jet was considerably better than that. We wanted the cell to be in the center 5 or 10% of that cross-sectional area. So we spent a lot of time with the fluidics design, that is, injecting the cells on the center line of the jet, being sure that they were in the center.
Part of the problem with fluidics was the small openings, the orifices, through which liquids had to pass. How to keep them from clogging? Electrical engineer Nicholas Vizades came up with a solution.
We run into a lot of difficulties, as is expected, and mainly the difficulties is orifice problems. How do you make a small, very small orifice of a few microns not to clog or in a uniform so that you can detect volumetrically the cells that they go through. We try to make orifices by our laboratory out of glass. We weren't successful in that. So the idea, I looked into the, I think, the jewels, watch jewels, and evidently that's a technology that was all foreign to me, but sure enough, that was the idea that we should use one of those things to let the cells pass through. There were a tremendous amount of excitement and home-built type stuff at the time.
Finding a suitable light source was a major optical problem.
The lasers didn't exist at the time, and we needed to have a strong light source to illuminate these fluorescent cells on the stream. We used xenon or mercury lamp, arc lamps, to do this, but again, we had difficulties concentrating this particular light and into the size of the stream through lenses and mirrors and whatnot.
Eventually, lasers saved the day, but not without their own problems.
None of us had worked with lasers before, and they took a lot of getting used to and caused lots of problems. In fact, they still do, but at that time, everything was new, and we spent a lot of our time trying to figure out what was happening with the lasers and why they didn't work the way we expected them to.
Processing and storing large amounts of data was another problem. Thomas Nozaki, an electronics engineer and computer specialist, was asked to help.
They hired me because they didn't have any computers with the cell sorters, per se. They had this Link 8, that wasn't kind of a very old computer. And when I started there, they just had purchased a GT44 system, which is a PDP-11, Digital Equipment Corporation type computer. And they wanted me to interface the cell sorter.
Working together, the engineering group was able to overcome the technical obstacles. Two successful prototypes were built, a 1969 instrument that employed a mercury arc lamp as light source, and a 1972 version which used an argon ion laser to detect cells tagged with fluorescent markers. Early funding, engineering help, and ideas for the development of the cell sorter came from the National Aeronautics and Space Administration's exobiology program at Stanford, whose goal was to look for life in outer space by building instruments to study soil samples from Mars and other planets.
Well, it was set up with funds from NASA, the space agency, with the inspiration and the stimulation and support of the chairman of the genetics department. It was Joshua Lederberg, who was interested in finding whether there was life in outer space and to examine the possibilities of that. And he wanted to build various kinds of instruments for that purpose. But he also had the idea that building an instrumentation research laboratory would have many functions for science here on Earth, in addition to the exobiological. And then we got an NIH grant, and there was a program at the National Institutes of Health for automating the clinical laboratory research program. We applied for money under that program, and we got it. And we then had our own support and continued working on it.
With that 1969 grant, they were able to perfect their first prototype cell sorter and win an even bigger grant from the NIH, this time from the War on Cancer funds, to build two machines, one for Stanford and one for the NIH, with the hope that they could become commercially viable. As a consultant on immunology to the medical products company Becton Dickinson, Herzenberg mentioned the project and grant to Bernie Shore, who was then managing a small Becton Dickinson satellite laboratory in Mountain View, California. Shore was interested.
It was very interesting for us because they were building a machine that could sort cells at very high rates of speed. And it was an engineer's dream in a way. It involved lasers, it involved electronics, it involved computers, it involved fluidics, and it was a pretty fun project. I was able to get approval to take on this project. And we reached an agreement with Stanford whereby we would build the two machines. And we put a small team of people together, approximately four people. And they worked directly with the scientists in Len Herzenberg's lab to essentially take what was what we would call a kludge, you know, a large assemblage of things all over the tables. We re-engineered it to create a product which we called the Fax One.
I thought it had tremendous potential. They didn't think it had much commercial potential. In fact, I think they thought that maybe if we built 10 machines over a long period of time, that would be the market. I thought that was wrong. They could build 30 and be able to sell them. But still, we greatly underestimated the potential market for these kinds of machines.
Well, we had an operating sorter by the time Beck and Dickinson arranged the contract to build two systems. And their charter really was to not to copy what we'd done, but to produce an instrument that was a manufacturable device that would duplicate the performance that we had. We operated very informally. We didn't have conventional engineering drawings. Most of the things were done by engineer sketches, engineering notebooks, and just conferences. And we had goals and directions from Len, of course, who knew what was useful to him and what he wanted. And we did our best to meet those. But often it was just a question of doing the best we could without knowing how close we would come to what he needed.
In fact, they came very close, and much faster than some of the engineers, such as Richard Stovall, thought possible.
There was also a lot of doubt in our minds as operators that BD could come up with a machine that, based on what we were doing, without a lot of years of development, that would be usable by the public, because there were so many things you had to nurse in operating our prototype. And I think in retrospect, we probably did better than we thought they were going to do.
The machines worked, and they worked very well. And as a result, other people started to want to buy the machines as well. Our best friends, our best salesmen, were the scientists in academia. And if somebody came to us and said, hey, why should we buy your machine? What can you do with it? We would typically send them to a university laboratory and say, go talk to those people, go see what they're doing.
The machine that Becton Dickinson began selling was called the Fax, which stood for Fluorescence Activated Cell Sorter. Part of the initial success of the instrument was due to its open design, which made it accessible and versatile.
And conceptually, it was a tool that could be modified. It could be modified by us. It could be modified by the customers, because many of the customers were leading-edge scientists. They had their own engineers. They had their own electronic people. We left lots of room to expand. Because the vision here was that we couldn't predict where this was going to go, what it would need next year, and we had to be flexible.
A great discovery that would have a huge impact on cell sorters was made in 1976. In Britain, Cesar Milstein and George Kohler discovered how to make hybrid cells that contained highly specific antibodies, which could be reproduced exactly and in endless quantities. They could also be easily stained with fluorescent dyes, and they readily latched on to very specific portions of cell surfaces, thereby labeling those cells and making them easy to sort. Len Herzenberg learned the technique for making monoclonal antibodies while on sabbatical in Milstein's laboratory in 1978, and immediately recognized their importance for cell sorting.
I guess, again, we got into the monoclonal business at the instigation of Len Herzenberg, who actually called me up from London and said, you've got to go make monoclonal antibodies. And my response that night, I think, was, what are they? You know, and we learned rather quickly what they were, and the corporation supported the setting up a laboratory to get involved in with monoclonal antibodies. Fax 1 was succeeded by Fax 2, by Fax 3, by Fax 4, and instruments that today are called FACSTAR Plus, at the high end of the line. They are distributed worldwide. We have machines in Africa, in China, in Japan, and virtually any country that you can name that has a adequate laboratory facilities to utilize it.
One of the key medical uses of today's cell sorters is in studying and monitoring the immune system of patients, sometimes on a daily, even hourly basis. How well is an immune system functioning? Are prescribed drugs working? Is a disease state advancing or retreating? Clinician Bruce Allen Bach cites two examples, childhood leukemia and AIDS.
This is an example of a childhood leukemia. In this first panel, we can see that there is very little nonspecific staining. Here's where the unique population of leukemic cells becomes apparent. This particular position of cell or cell cluster would never be seen in normals. It is a combination of an immaturity antigen with a marker of B cells. So already, just by this unique cluster of cells being present, we know this child has a leukemia. This slide represents the difference between a normal individual and an individual who's infected with human immunodeficiency virus with regard to the activation set of the different cells which make up the immune system. In the normal, we can see the normal B cells or antibody secreting cells, which are identified by their fluorescence here. T cells are identified by their fluorescence with this marker, which is associated with T cells. Notice that in normals, there's a small number of activated T cells. They're present, but not in great number. If we now turn to an individual infected with human immunodeficiency virus, we see a decrease in the number of B cells, some activated non-B cells, and a large increase in the activated T cell population. This slide represents how the flow cytometer can take a single marker, which can be both an activation marker and a cell identification marker, and show how it is an appropriate way of studying a disease state.
Today, some researchers in the Herzenberg's laboratory are focusing their attention on the AIDS virus. They are using the fax machine to study the activity of single genes within individual cells. They want to know what activates the virus in helper T cells and how to monitor it there. Monty Montano, a graduate student in the lab, explains one research design.
Essentially, we can quantitate the number of viral particles and their infectious activity using the fax machine. Furthermore, because this system can be adopted for viable cell genetics, we can study the infection in viable living cells. The goal is to develop it in such a way so as to use it with clinical monitoring of patients and drug therapy so that we have a readout of the efficacy within the same week as the therapy is being undertaken.
Mark Krasno is applying a similar technique to his study of embryonic animal development.
And I think eventually this kind of technology will be able to be applied to many different types of animals, including some animals that are even more closely related to humans, like the mouse. And I think the goal eventually will be to not only study, for example, the development of the nervous system in vitro, which we've started to do with these Drosophila embryos where beta-galactoside is expressed in the progenitors of the nervous system, but also to then begin to reconstruct development of a whole animal from different sets of purified cells and see if we can reconstruct development in a test tube in vitro from mixtures of these purified cells. Put the animal back together again after taking the animal apart cell by cell because of this kind of an assay system.
Uses for cell sorters in biology and medicine continue to multiply. Some of the major players in the development of this instrument reflect on its significance and think about its future.
Historically, cells were analyzed qualitatively through a microscope using dyes that would stain certain parts of cells, and cells would be described as this kind of a cell because it would take that kind of a dye, and so on. All of these are qualitative descriptions, which, of course, hide any difference among a certain class of cells. The development of quantitative methods of analyzing optical and physical properties of cells allows you a much greater range of things to ask. You can ask many more questions of cells. You're asking, how is a cell living? How is it doing its thing? How does it perform the actions that it performs? So I see the future as being the development of more specific probes for different cellular properties, probes that will analyze physiologic function, will measure some of the things going on chemically, biochemically inside of a cell. And I see these kinds of measurements as being of increasing importance and really penetrating to the heart of the biology, which is more what a cell does than how it looks.
I'd just like to add to Mac's list the fact that you can not only study cells with flow cytometry and sorting techniques, you can study any biological particle that you can put into suspension and stain in a significant way. So you can study subcellular structures. And the one that I've been involved in heavily in the last decade or so, more than the last decade, the last 15 years or so, is the cellular chromosome, which is a very important substructure of the cell and contains all the cell's genes and genetics. So this cellular component is of great interest to genetics people and to the human genomics project, the Human Genome Project, that's currently an important feature of the landscape, both in this country and abroad.
Our own work focused for a while on regulation of the immune response. We isolated with the sorters the cells which were suppressor cells, cells which were antibody-forming cell precursors, T cells which were helper cells, and saw how they interacted. That was a major area of activity for us at one point. We then moved into some more molecular kinds of studies where we were able to use the sorter, the FACS, to help us to clone genes. So we transferred DNA from cells of one species, usually human, into recipient cells, which were usually mouse. And the expression of the human genes for cell surface antigens could be detected on the surface of the mouse cells, so the human antigens expressed on the surface of the mouse cells, by staining with fluorescein or other fluorochrome conjugated monoclonal antibodies, and then using the FACS to sort out these cells, and by a complicated process, but not so uncommon in molecular biology and gene cloning, we were able to clone the genes for several of the basically important cell surface molecules. And some of these are now very important in clinical work.
From the atomic bomb project to NASA's search for life in outer space came ideas and technologies which became embodied in the cell sorter, an instrument which has automated the task of identifying and quantitatively analyzing individual cells and of separating and sorting closely related cell populations. The innovative scientists and engineers who invented this instrument successfully integrated ideas from the newly emerging technologies of lasers and computers together with new adaptations in hydrodynamics and optics in order to build a powerful tool for biomedical research and clinical medicine. The horizons for applying this new instrument are still being probed. The initial results have been exciting and rewarding.